Good morning.
The 11 o'clock waffle is back.
That it is.
Big time.
With a vengeance.
With a vengeance.
It could be said.
Yeah.
No, like John McClane.
John McClane and a vest and no shoes.
Yippee-ki-yay.
Yippee-ki-yay indeed. Now, we're trying a new way of recording the show this week, so hopefully it's going to work.
Fingers, toes and other extremities crossed.
Let's see if we can get these things to work.
Do they work?
Is it plugged in the right bit?
I do not know.
It appears to be working.
I think you can hear it over the headset. Can it work over the headset? Yeah, it works over the headset.
Not this one. I don't think I'm plugged in though.
Ah. This one's plugged in.
It's probably unplugged in.
You want to try that one?
Go.
Ka-ching. Yeah, we are using the fighting talk sound effects this week.
Because somebody has been kind enough to upload them.
That's a football show for the uninitiated, correct?
Sports show.
It's raining outside.
Ah, we had bright sunshine last week. Where is Callum?
Who knows?
He's been killed.
Abducted.
For his beard.
We could have the points off sound for Callum for not being here.
How many points does he lose first?
I don't know. He's not here at the minute, so he can't really score any. What else? Well, we could try some music. Hang on. Let's see if this works.
Yep, it's working.
What is it?
It's the Godfather.
Do you want that to be your tune this week?
No, because I'm not in the mob.
I'm in the mob. Send it this
contrary
way.
Contrary to popular belief, I'll stick with Team Rocket, thanks.
Oh, okay. Hang on, we could give you this. They say
I
might as well
face the truth, but I'm not dying.
How about some bagpipes?
That should be yours, surely.
Yeah. Let's see if we can get the actual tunes working then, whilst we wait for Callum to arrive.
I can see a bus in the bus stop.
Okay.
If not, he'll stand up.
Introducing this week's returning guest, the experienced veteran.
Yes, indeed.
Mr. James.
12 tours.
Mr. James Joseph Miller. James's theme tune. How are you feeling today, James?
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I think we've got a good chance of winning.
It's the newbies. Well, one of them's not even here yet.
Yep. So chances are already looking better.
Yeah.
That being said, though, Joe has got an impressive computer-typed
script
for his answers.
He's
much more prepared than I am.
So have we got any tunes that would be good for... We could always... As he's not turned up yet, we could always give Callum this one. Non-existent Callum.
Ooh, from the ether he comes to us.
did we decide on a theme for Joe, or
did you want the Godfather?
I would very much like the Godfather
theme. I'm just seeing what else we got on this. We could always give you. Apt.
Indeed.
Oh, hang on, pushing it again and it's playing.
Cheers.
Okay. I believe that is our one bit of promotion for the year done.
Awesome.
So, on with the show.
We are
some
into
pictures
a on the
and
website.
Yeah.
Me looking glorious as usual.
So, No, Callum as of yet. We might as well start with the show. And I love the new sound effects. Even if we can't. Well, I should probably turn that up first. Can we have headphones? We might have to. No, I'm sure the headphones used to like be plugged in and working.
Yeah. These ones just don't seem to be making noise.
Well, it is making noise, so I'll just have to do it in my head.
Yeah.
Shall we proceed?
Proceed.
We shall.
Okay. Shrek the Sheep. Anybody remember Shrek the Sheep?
No.
Shrek the Sheep, the New Zealand-born sheep who became world famous after dodging shearers for 6 years, has died. Definitely worth looking up. It is the most hilarious picture of a sheep you'll ever see. Because like his wool hasn't been sheared for 6 years, so the sheep is huge.
There is no sheep. It's just.
It's just a massive fur. So, other tales of animals who did extraordinary things. James, do you like to lead the way?
Not particularly. This was one of the questions I didn't have time to come up with an answer for. But come back to me. I'll think of something.
I got an animal, if you'd like to hear about the
yes.
one I found. So, a while ago, a friend told me about a bear. Not just any bear. This bear was a soldier in the Second World War. Apparently, some Polish troops found it just walking in Iran on the way to Turkey or something, and this bear was called Wojtek, and apparently they adopted it, and it danced and drank beer and just chilled with the troops and was their friend, and eventually they actually trained it to carry ammunition around.
Nice.
And just ravage people on the battlefield with its mighty claws.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, and so this bear was actually like enlisted in their ranks and went with them around all Europe on campaigns. Now, I mean, obviously, aside from the animal rights concerns, which are pretty numerous with this case.
Yeah.
Dancing, beer, drinking.
It's quite a
bear.
Cool thing, you know, having a bear as your sort of brother-in-arms following you around.
Yeah, you'd definitely feel safe having
it. I would do.
I have a lion sound effect. I don't know if that quite covers bear.
Not really.
A casual observer might mistake the two.
Yeah. Dom might get confused.
Bears are more.
No doubt.
Yeah. It's an excellent start, James, if you had time to think.
Well, on a similar note of military animals, the dolphins that they trained to disarm mines and attack submarines are pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dolphins?
And they did the same thing with seals. The dolphins would use their echolocation to find out mines and stuff, and then they would sometimes give them mines to plant on like the insides of boats and stuff. So, attack from the ocean.
Nice.
So Aquaman is attacking communism or whoever they were fighting.
Were they trained to bore holes in ships?
Unfortunately, no. That would be fantastic. But I think you need like
saboteurs,
narwhal or something for that.
Yes, indeed. Well, I heard about the bat bombs in the First World. I believe it may have been the First World War or something like that. They trained bats to fly at the enemy, strapped with like some sort of explosive, dynamite.
Like pigeons as well. They did that with.
Yeah.
Suicide pigeons. No, the pigeons would peck at something.
Airborne attacks from various forms of wildlife.
Yeah.
Ingenious. You think it's a carrier pigeon coming with mail and boom!
Animal rights issues up there, but it's time of war.
I wonder what this noise is. Oh, it's a boing noise.
It says boing on the descriptor, so it's kind of onomatopoeic.
Could have a great escape music as well, actually, if we're talking about the war. That apparently doesn't make any difference switching that dial. Should we move on to question two?
Go on, Em.
Question two. Cheryl Cole. It's always a good start to a question, isn't it?
Good God.
Cheryl Cole has lost her job on American X Factor after reports she apparently could not be understood by contestants. Interestingly enough, Kelly Rowland, the American woman who is now on British X Factor, can't understand the contestants from Birmingham, but she can still have a job.
Can you explain who Kelly Rowland is?
She was one of Destiny's Child.
Oh, she was a child of Destiny.
Yeah, she wasn't.
Apparently, did Survivor.
She was. Yeah, she wasn't Beyonce. She was one of the ones that wasn't Beyonce.
Okay, right.
She was the other one of the other ones.
So who else in the world of entertainment would you like to see lose their job because of their birthplace?
In the world, specifically have to be in the world of entertainment.
Well, have you been thinking outside of the world of entertainment?
Well, my initial answer was, eventually when they get old enough to have jobs, Katie Price's children, because she is their place of birth and she is a travesty.
I think this sums up accurately. Is that going to be your answer then?
Yeah.
See, Joe, what have you got?
I went for the entire ensemble cast of The Only Way Is Essex, which I'm sure many of you are aware is a blight upon our screens.
I'm afraid I've never seen it, so.
You're a lucky man. some may disagree, but I personally despise the show and the lifestyle it stalls.
And they've now got Geordie Shore as well, haven't they? Which is Newcastle again.
Yeah, I heard about that.
There's some people complaining that it presents Newcastle in a bad light, and others are like, no, it's a good image for the city to have.
Party city, yeah.
Yeah. To be honest, it's going to be a tight show without Callum here. Where is Callum?
I fear for his safety.
Indeed. If anybody sees Callum, tell him he should be here. I don't think we have trained ninjas.
Oh. You don't. I might. Who knows?
You don't know, right?
No.
Okay.
Freya's listening. We should say hi to Freya.
Hi, Freya.
Shout out to Freya.
She has to go to work soon, I believe.
Enjoy shoe job.
Yeah. Should we move on to question three. Twitter has played an important role in the whole injunction saga. But what is the greatest ever tweet? We should do a shout out to that. Carla is on Twitter.
Is she?
Yeah.
It's Carla.
Tweet, tweet, Carla. Tweet, tweet.
Tweet, tweet.
What I twa putty tit.
Isn't that what we tweeted the other week on the show? Yeah. Is that your answer?
No.
Joe, what have you got? You've had a strong start to the show.
Well, I gave this some thought, and I obviously came up. The guy that tweeted the Bin Laden raids, quite obviously a noted tweet.
Yes.
He described it was happening, some helicopters are circling my house. It turned out it was the American capture of the man himself.
Hang on, I have USA music, apparently.
We're born in
the USA. It's the national anthem. Go on, Joe.
And also, there was, if anyone remembers, the Hayley Williams debacle from the not-so-noted band Paramore. She tweeted some topless pictures or something, and it spread across the web, and she was really upset about that.
Just remind the male listeners who this was.
Hayley Williams of the band Paramore. She's a pretty average singer from an even more average band. But
I would agree.
she did do that.
I haven't got any celebrity ones, but I was just... Because I hate Twitter, I don't use it, so I never really have much cause to come in contact with it, but I was just looking through some lists of what people have voted as the best tweets of all time. One of them I thought was hilarious. It was just some regular guy who tweeted that he was forming a coalition government with his wife to take control of the house back from the cat. Your reign of terror is over. I thought it was just hilarious. The thought of this cat just being tyrannical in keeping these people prisoner in their own home.
Oh, why do we not have a cat sound effect? Meow. Well, there we go.
Do we have keyboard cat?
No. Oh. Meow.
We've got our own trained keyboard cat.
So, Callum's not doing too well. Meow. Let's see. Shall we put the scores music on from Fighting Talk?
Yeah.
Good as us sort of score music normally.
The dramatic crack of doom.
Crack of doom falling. In last place on no points, it's Callum because he's not shown up.
Woo!
On 10, it's James. Boom. And narrowly in the lead on 11, it's Joe.
Yes.
That was a nice bumper-free question start to kick back the return of the show. So
the win can't last for long.
There's only two of you. It's going to be pretty close. And if there's one straggler, then it's all over.
Yeah.
Time to go on for some music now. This is All the Things She Said by Tattoo. We should discuss this. That was All the Things She Said by Tattoo, according to Dom. Apparently that's how you say it.
Yeah, it is how you say it.
Yeah.
It does sound a little bit like E.T., this is true, but not massively so.
Would you like to crack out your keyboard cat one more time for Lucy? Back on with the show. I wonder if it's louder if I just do it this way. That seems to work. Just do it like that. We'll
be able
to
hear it.
I don't know. Who cares?
Forget them.
Forget them. It's all about Joe. We'll make Joe cry in a minute.
Yeah, apparently.
I wonder if there's a sound effect for you to cry.
Is there something I don't know about to transpire on the
possibly,
radio
you never know with Mac.
Some. Well, we could have.
Ooh. Violent initiation, right?
That'd be quite dramatic music to have near the end. I don't think there's any real sort of. What's this one?
Can have that when we decide who's lost.
I almost the point one. I like that point. There we go. Music, you might have recognised Tattoo, All the Things She Said, for having a video involving two Russian women in the rain, dressed as schoolgirls, baking out a lot. That was pretty much how that entire video and song was sold. But music videos could be set to give an age certificate ratings. These new guidelines have been brought in the whole wave of videos becoming more and more explicit. So what is the most outrageous music video you have ever watched, James?
Well, I don't particularly watch music videos, but I seem to recall pretty much every music video of the 80s being ridiculously stupid in some way or other. So perhaps not outrageous in the way that you mean it, but
the 80s still videos.
Outrageous in the stupidity and bizarreness on the whole. So I'm just going to go for the 80s.
It's when the music video era really took off, the 80s.
Yeah.
It's probably why they were so bizarre and stupid. They were just messing about with them, trying to see what they could do. But yeah.
Durab Duran essentially made the music video. Well, before
I don't watch music videos, so.
Before music videos,
question for me.
Were just like the band singing, and that was it.
There were occasional promotional videos,
but they weren't really much. Duran Duran were the first ones that actually caught into the, because that was like around MTV time as well, and they were the first ones that like started to make like films out of their music videos, just like where they go to Rio and all of that.
They do have some very good music videos.
Rio,
how do you like about them?
Hungry Like the Wolf.
Yeah. One of them is actually Duran Duran. Dredged up for this.
Nice. So is that your answer, James?
Yeah.
The 80s.
It's a rubbish answer to a, for me, a rubbish question, because I don't watch music videos.
We could just have that sound effect in. Joe, what have you got?
Okay, so the first thing I thought of was the infamous Smack My Bitch Up by the Prodigy, which is a music video about a girl that goes on a massive sort of binge, does drugs, has sex, etc., has fights. Was very hated at the time, got a lot of press, bad press, was banned from most MTV, I think, at least. Also, Girls on Film by Duran Duran had to be censored by MTV to be aired and was banned by the BBC. Lots of gratuitous nudity and stuff in there.
They filmed it in a strip club.
Did they?
Yeah.
With the catwalk thing in the boxing room.
Yeah, they filmed they filmed one in a strip club.
Oh, quite a good song that, but
I have the vinyl on my wall.
Really?
The single six inch vinyls, was it?
I don't know.
Yeah, the Girls on Film vinyl. Next to the Ultravox Vienna vinyl.
So you are quite a hardcore fan.
Hardcore fan of Duran Duran. I watched them live on that ITV thing they did, like they did the audience with. Simon Le Bon's like 50. Still pumping the moves out with a beard.
Remember on the View to a Kill video, it's like Le Bon, Simon Le Bon.
Oh, it's the best thing about the film, though, because the film's terrible.
The film is pretty awful.
You got any more?
Just one more. I thought I
one of my favourite songs of my teenage years, which is One by Metallica. Has a very hard-hitting music video based on the film Johnny Got His Gun, which is a propagandist anti-war film. Very, it's about a guy that's lost all his limbs, face, etc., etc. Has sensory deprivation. So.
So he's Darth Vader.
Well, he's Darth Vader, but he can't communicate or anything. So he's it's a very hard-hitting video. Made an impact on me at least. Not sure whether it was banned or anything.
Cool. It's going to be interesting. It's worth tuning in this week just to hear the new sound effects that we're trying out.
Yeah.
On to question 5. You know, I wish Callum was here, because it's 11:27. We're almost halfway through the questions. Which never happens. Human Centipede 2. Anybody seen Human Centipede 1?
No.
Seen it.
Sick.
Very. It was...
Freya's gone.
Oh.
Bye, Freya.
I'm sure she's already gone.
Yeah. In case she hadn't.
Human Centipede was a very unpleasant film to watch.
I imagine so, that's why I haven't watched it.
The centipede itself was all covered up, so it wasn't particularly sort of gruesome, but yeah. Just the thought of it itself.
I got ill just reading the synopsis.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, old Tony and Gemma had a viewing party for
Yeah, I remember.
I think I believe Jenny bought the DVD or something, so we all had to go and watch it. Coerced.
Human Centipede 2 is out now. It's been denied a certificate by the BBFC, meaning it cannot currently be shown in British cinemas without permission from local councils. Have you read what's in the new film that makes it so bad? Apparently it starts with a man watching the first film having some man time with some sandpaper.
Nice.
So they start saying to go on then.
It gets worse. They find a use for barbed wire. Just leave it there.
Okay,
please do.
If you want to find out why, it's available to look up online. BBFC's reasons for banning it. But what films do you wish had been banned from the cinema so you did not waste your money viewing them? I'd like to start this one by saying Alien Autopsy with Anton Deck.
Yeah.
One of the worst films it's ever been my misfortune to spend money.
I didn't go see it in the cinema, I watched it on the telly, so...
Spent £5 to go see that and it was terrible. Anyway, Joe, worst film you wished you hadn't paid to see?
Well, I couldn't think of many because I've set my sights quite low at the cinema. As long as it makes me laugh or keeps me vaguely entertained, I feel like I've got my money's worth. But one I didn't particularly like was Your Highness. I watched the trailers, thought it was going to be good, but as ever, they put the most funny scenes of the whole film in the trailers and it was extremely overly the top crude. Slapstick, no real sort of depth to the comedy, really bad timing, so that's one for the bin, I think.
Yeah. James.
See, I generally only go and see films I know are going to be good, but if I had to say any film that I was disappointed with having paid ridiculous amounts of money to go and see, I would say Transformers Revenge of the Fallen, because it was terrible. Really was.
Transformers.
I think it suffered mostly from the writer's strike, but I mean, The Fallen was a terrible bad guy, the plot was full of holes, and the stupid comedy from the two twin Autobots is just. I can't stand it, it just shouldn't have been there. And, the joke with Devastator's gentleman.
I've not seen it yet, but I've got it to watch. I think. That deserves
an arrow to Michael Bay's face.
And hang on. I think this where is it? This deserves your opinion on the film. That accurate?
Yeah.
By the way, people listening in, feel free to get involved on the Facebook page, 11 o'clock Waffle. We're apparently the only show running today. I think it's reached that stage of term where...
Everybody's gone.
Everyone goes and they finish the work and they decide that they don't need to do the... come up and do the radio. But we're here. We shall be here for the next hour and a half.
doing God knows what, because we're probably going to run out of questions.
Yeah, that's why we need Lucy and Dom to start commenting with answers of their own.
Maybe they could pose us questions to answer.
Yeah, yes, pose questions. Here is Hey Judy by Fountains of Wayne. That was Craig David with 7 days. Before that, we had One Night Only with You and Me. And before that, Fountains of Wayne with Hey Julie. The sun's starting to peak out now.
Yeah, it's picking up.
It's quite good.
Rain has gone. For this, I am thankful.
That is, it's always nice when the weather like that. I mean, you've had the rain, but there's sun.
Changeable.
Yep. Let's see, where are we? Question 6. Since we finished the work, I've been treating to myself. I'm watching Huxley Pig.
I don't know what that is.
It was an awesome kids TV show.
I too was not familiar with Huxley Pig.
Plasticine Pig, voiced by Martin Jarvis. And he had a dress-up box, and every episode he would dress up in something and imagine what life would be like as that.
Mm.
It's very good. Lots of quite funny rude jokes in it as well.
I see.
Yeah. But what is your favourite childhood TV show?
I've got a few for this one.
Shall we go to you first or second then?
If you come to me first if you like.
Go first then.
First of all, Transformers, the original cartoon series from the 80s.
I'm surprised at that actually.
Why?
Yeah, you never use Transformers as an answer on the show.
True, I don't. It's a rare occasion. That's my all-time favourite because it was just so fantastic for a kid, but having watched it back now, it is just, they are just ridiculous.
They're terrible.
They were pretty bad, but still, I love them. Animals and Fatherhood was always great.
Yep.
And Come Outside with Pippin, the dog.
Don't remember that one.
Oh, there's a lady, and a rather portly lady, who lived in the country with her dog, and she had a spotted plane.
Yeah,
that she took the dog and she flew around and would go places. It was really educational for kids because she would fly around, she would go to places and show them how everything happened at places, and it was wicked. There's just a little dog with a pilot's cap and goggles and the plane. It was wicked.
Let's see, got some good shows there. Is worth tuning in for the new sound effects this week. Do you agree, James?
I do.
Joe?
Much preferable.
Childhood TV shows.
I too had difficulty nailing this one down. I was a fan of... I sadly didn't watch Transformers, but I was a fan of the lesser-known Beast Wars.
Yes!
Beast Wars was alright.
I watched Beast Wars.
I very much enjoyed Beast Wars.
Yeah, Beast Wars was alright.
It was Transformers just with animals, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was one of the shoot-offs, and
used to watch Beast Wars. It was good.
Primals and the Predacons and the Maximals.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, Predacons and Maximals. That's it. Same characters, different forms.
Yeah. There's like a rat thing, that was the cheeky one.
Unlimited rat franchise. Waspinator, of course. Waspinator. Who was Starscream, but was made into Waspinator.
I had that on toy. I had the shark as a toy.
I had the giant manta ray one.
I had the evil lobster. And the baboon.
The gorilla.
There was a baboon. The one that wasn't actually the leader. But if you actually saw it all the way through to the end, they actually came across the proper Transformers. The evil Megatron wanted to destroy the Ark, which was the spaceship that the original Transformers came to Earth on, and that was where the final episode ended.
How many series were there? It's got to be about maybe two or three.
But I think the final few episodes took place on board the Ark, and when you saw them next to the actual Transformers, they were tiny. They were actually tiny.
Alright, I've also got a couple of obvious ones. Everyone loves Kenan and Kel.
Yes.
Who loves orange soda?
Kel loves orange soda. There's obviously, maybe not so obviously, but still very good. Maybe when we're slightly older, Jackie Chan animated adventures.
Jackie Chan adventures were great.
Yeah.
One more thing.
That was the uncle or the granddad.
Uncle!
Always listen to Uncle.
Do you know what's hilarious about that? She had the big giant sumo guy in the first episode, and
he was
unbeatable.
Yeah, he was.
The minute he joined Jackie Chan, kept getting beaten every week.
Yeah, he was humbled.
Yeah, what was it's the rule? No,
the evil Chi was the Dao Long Wong.
I think the only person that switched sides and become better is Teal'c in Stargate.
He didn't. Well, he only switched sides in like the first episode.
Yeah,
but you know, like in shows where they switch, like in Jackie Chan, he was unbeatable in that first episode. Switches sides and then he's always getting caught.
He didn't switch sides after the first episode.
Did he?
So,
about five or six.
It's quite a way in that he actually switches and he gets beaten up all the time. Before that, so it's not quite the drastic change.
Good guys always win, so.
Jackie Chan.
It's Jackie Chan.
Finally, I've got the Mighty Ducks. Everyone loves the Mighty Ducks. Very good, very good.
It
was amazing.
It was stupid. The character names were rubbish.
Mighty Ducks.
It was just ridiculous.
It was amazing.
No, it wasn't.
And they had the Saurians, the evil lizard people, and they were really
wasn't
amazing.
Good.
Every fan of the film will agree, you know, Mike, like the movie, the Mighty Ducks.
Which one? Mighty Ducks,
with the actual people playing hockey, they were good.
Well, the Mighty Ducks played hockey in the animated show as well, they did action as well. They had puck shooters and stuff.
It was ridiculous.
Oh, I was a fan.
Ah, look what comes up on YouTube. Keenan and Kel, Who Loves Orange Soda, Part 1.
Is it a montage?
That on YouTube! I think we know what we're doing this afternoon.
I'm not.
You're not watching Keenan and Kel.
I thought you were trying. I thought it was parody music video. Really. I was getting excited there for a minute. Coolio in the titles.
As much as I love Keenan and Kel, I'm not going to spend my afternoon watching it.
We all know the lyrics. Keep you laughing in the afternoon.
What's a bizarre opening title sequence for a kids' TV show?
It is pretty awesome.
I remember them being really old, they look quite young. Apparently Dominique hated Keenan and Kel, can you believe this?
I know.
What to say, really.
She'll think she's going to burst.
Chris Stanley's come out with a good one.
Chip and Dale.
Rescue Rangers.
Yeah.
They were awesome.
Get the box set of that in Asda for
£7.
£7? Yeah, I don't think it's there anymore.
Quite a few.
It's like three. It was like three disc one, I think. Three, six discs. Got some very good stuff coming out from the children's TV.
Danger Mouse is always good.
Danger Mouse. X-Men.
I know it's not really a show, but Basil the Great Mouse Detective was awesome.
Oh,
the film.
Redwall, that was an odd TV show.
Oh, Redwall was awesome.
Not the cartoon series.
Yeah.
The books were awesome. Books the cartoon were, series.
I loved the cartoon as well.
Cartoon was... I
liked it, yeah.
I could never quite get
down. Redwall!
Because the books were so violent. And then the cartoon was like all chirpy.
It can't always be watered down, can it?
Make them anthropomorphic talking animals and you can get away with anything.
Should we move from childhood memories to X-Men First Class?
If you like.
X-Men First Class, before we were at the box office. But who is your favourite of the X-Men?
Gambit, clearly. He's
high five.
Awesome. Fellow Gambit.
Get a louder one for the sound effect.
It's better.
Well,
Gambit is just all kinds of awesome. One of the best powers, and he's just so cool. Significantly underused in the films, I think, because he's a much better character than
Would
that.
You say he was misrepresented in the Wolverine one?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
he was.
Though I did enjoy that film. He was completely unnecessary character.
Unnecessary and not that well cast, I don't think.
What,
he wasn't Cajun enough.
Do you know who was meant to play him though?
No.
Josh Holloway, who played Sawyer in Lost.
I don't know.
That would have been awesome.
And they offered it him and he turned it down.
I've lost all respect now.
Like he was Gambit.
Dead to me. He if he's listening in right now, he can.
Joe Holloway. Yeah. We've reached Bermuda, by the way. My uncle's listening.
Oh, wicked.
We've boomed
shouting
abroad.
Out to Bermuda, we have crossed the international border.
We hit Wales, that's as far as we've got. So, I like Gambit. Gambit's my favourite.
While we're on the subject of Gambit, I can also say that I'm a fan of Rogue as well. Not the rubbish Rogue from the films, but proper Rogue. With all her stolen abilities from Miss Marvel. What I hate about Rogue and Gambit in the films is that they're supposed to be an item, they are supposed to be something going on, but they're not in films, and that's rubbish. So you've got that stupid thing going on with Iceman, who should have been like 20 years older than her, because he was one of the original X-Men.
Not a fan of Iceman.
Iceman played by...
Some idiot.
No, I'm trying to think what he's called. He's played by the guy who played Jimmy Olsen in Smallville, but they're identical twins. This guy who played Iceman was in an early season of Smallville as a baddie, and he takes Clark Kent's powers.
I see.
And then his identical twin brother turned up a few seasons later as Jimmy Olsen.
That must have been confusing.
We used to wind up my housemate Ellie by saying that Iceman was in Smallville and the other one was in X-Men.
But yeah, Iceman was supposed to be part of the original lineup, so.
Yeah. Dom saying Rogue is H-O-T.
Yep.
And
she is a bit in the films, yep.
No, and not in the films.
Now it's James McAvoy.
McAvoy?
Yep, McAvoy. So
who's he playing? Is it Professor X?
Yeah. Professor X. And now she's saying Jimmy. And.
Who's that?
Jimmy Olsen.
Oh, okay.
And Christopher Stanley's for Going for the Beast. Of course, played by Nicholas Holt in the new film.
Oh, is it?
From about a boy in Skins.
Powers are quite limited, though. Sadly, the Beast can only—he's quite like agile, but
agile, hairy, and strong.
Oh, thank you, Chris Stanley, for that. Sean Ashmore plays Iceman. Aaron Ashmore is his identical twin brother. Do you have another song?
Oh, we're on a Joe's answer on this.
I thought he was going Gambit as well.
Identical.
Yeah.
It's a Gambit.
Let's just have points for everybody.
I could also go into Bad Guys.
You could also go into what?
Bad Guys from X-Men as well.
Oh, you could do,
it's not always for good guys, is it? Good characters. Mr. Sinister, freaking awesome.
Yeah.
He was like Cyclops and Jean Grey's arch nemesis. He was a self-made mutant. He was a scientist in Victorian England who experimented on himself and made himself indestructible and like could shoot lasers from his face and stuff.
Cool.
Cyclops... was like the only one who could actually damage it with his power.
His fourth Cyclops was a bit awful, to be honest.
Yeah, and he would occasionally destroy him, and Jean Grey would scatter him to the four winds, and it would take him forever to sort of reassemble himself.
Alright, should we have the scores before we get to the song, before 12 o'clock?
Yeah, if you like.
That's quite good, actually, for drum music. In third place on no points, it's Callum.
Woo!
Zero for Callum, people.
We need a booing sound, really.
That's unsportsmanly.
Unsport what? For not turning up?
It's probably listening in now.
Booing people, just...
I'm sorry.
Points off, Mac. Points off for you.
On second place on 19, it's James.
I'm not having a very good show of it today.
To be fair, after Joe cracked out all of those TV shows, 23 points.
That was a story and a half.
23 points. It's Joe in the lead.
Thank you.
Hopefully, I can.
Just glad to be here.
Claw some points back.
Yeah. So, to take you into 12 o'clock now, we have the brilliance of Oasis with "Live Forever."
Good song.
That was Oasis with "Live Forever."
If only I could.
If only. On to question 8 now. A man has been jailed for 6 weeks after stealing a limited first edition Harry Potter novel from an art gallery. But what are you willing to do jail time for in order to acquire something? James.
When you say do jail time for to acquire something, do you mean I would still get the thing that I acquire after doing the jail time, or...?
Yeah.
Okay.
You hide it somewhere.
So is the act of... taking the thing that gets me jail time.
Yeah.
Okay, that's clarified that. Well, I would love myself a 1967 fastback Mustang or a Ford GT40. So I would steal them quite gladly. But yeah. Then, having thought about it, I would gladly do jail time for kidnapping Summer Glau.
Who?
Summer Glau, star of Serenity, Firefly,
Sarah Connor Chronicles, Cape. Some other things, the Cape. In a new film coming out soon, Knights of Badassdom.
I'm not really sure we are having a pro. Well, we could have a bit of. No? I think that pretty much covers the Summer Glau thing. Joe, what have you got?
I had a real tough time thinking about this, and I guess it would completely depend on how much jail time is on the cards here, really. We're looking at, what, a couple of years, maybe? 6 months?
Depends what you're stealing.
Well, I don't know. Freedom is the most prized resource we have, so... I don't know, I guess I wouldn't mind stealing $1 million. I might trade that for... pounds, seeing as I don't know why I said dollars. Watch too many heist movies.
Depends which way the exchange rate is at the minute.
So you say I'm doing it. I guess I'd happily do a couple of months for that, maybe. No more.
Hang on, where's the cash register sound effect? That's all we got. That covers money. And that covers.
Set you up. Get whatever you want. You know.
Yeah.
Only $1 million, no?
Well, I don't want to get greedy, do I?
Okay, question number 9. It's coming on barbecue season, so what is your favourite barbecue food?
Do you want to start?
Okay, well, it's got to be steak for me. Lovely grilled steak, so nice. Smoky. Done with just a little bit of pink in the middle.
Yeah.
My mouth's watering just thinking about it.
Fantastic.
Mm. Obviously, also, good sausage. Just basic good sausage. Nice. Especially if it's, you know, good quality meat.
I do a fire sound effect on it somewhere.
Fire!
Does it? It won't play.
Key stipulation here is the bun has to be good. The bun can ruin an entire meal.
Yeah.
If it's crap bread, then it may as well be dead.
James, what have you got?
For breakfast on the barbecue, bacon and pancakes. If you've got a good enough barbecue for it.
Nice.
Which I happen to have at home, which is fantastic. Some, maple cured bacon and some pancakes done on the barbecue. It's even better if you're on the beach, which I did in Australia, which is fantastic. Sunrise, bacon and pancakes on the barbecue on the beach, which is awesome. And then for any other time, a good bit of fish, generally tuna or salmon on the barbecue, I love.
Tuna, salmon going the other day, actually.
Tuna. I prefer to have been marinated in something beforehand, but yeah.
Yeah, and your pasta salads as well are always appreciated. Should we do the scores in a minute?
Go on.
Hang on, I'm just working out some stuff. Christopher Stanley's having a good game. So, the weather has gone down a bit now. How do you think you're performing now, the show, Joe? You look enjoying your time?
Pretty confident, yeah. Thought I came prepared, did my homework.
Yeah, seems much more prepared than I am. That's for sure.
So, okay, in last place on naught, it's Callum, because he hasn't turned up.
Poor Callum.
He
could be dead, you know.
Could be. Yeah, he's not put. It's not Facebook, so not official. In eighth place,
in
fourth place, it's Dominique on 8.
Yay!
Christopher Stanley's on 12.
Yay! People playing from home is always fun.
James is on 24.
Bleep, bleep, bleep.
And Joe is in the lead on 26. Managed to pull back the lead slightly.
2-point lead.
So we'll move.
Still anyone's game.
We'll move onwards now with a food-related song. Hopefully, Maya and the Follies members are listening. Here is a Little Priest. That was. Little Priest by Helena Bonham Carter and Johnny Depp from the Sweeney Todd soundtrack. On to question 10 now. It's 11 minutes past 12. Show's going very well today. Question 10. Doctor Who had its mid-season finale on Saturday, which promised to be game-changing. But what examples can you give an event in television or film that is truly game-changing? James, you're a big TV fan.
Yeah, I've gone from day 6 of 24, wherein Jack Bauer discovers that the bad guy he's got to bring down is actually the President of the United States. That properly changes the game for the entire, for that particular season.
Yeah.
And then what will then come in the preceding two further series, because he actually brings down the President of the United States. He becomes a wanted fugitive.
Yeah.
He has to flee the country. He gets captured by the Chinese. He gets tortured. He gets brought back by his own government to fight off another terrorist attack, and it just completely changes everything for him.
Yeah.
And it's just freaking awesome, because 24 is amazing.
Yeah. Good show.
Jack Bauer is the best TV tough man in existence ever.
Hang on. I'm sure we have it here.
About Liam Neeson and Taken, he's quite
fabulous. Yeah, but he's Irish.
Oh.
And that's a one-off. Jack Bauer's consistently badass.
Mm. Yeah. Just trying out what that LA Law was. We also have the, if you have any one-liners. Nope. Joe, what have you got?
Well, I take game-changing to mean sort of changing the realm of television to raising the bar, so to speak. Now, I'm going to start off with a very geeky dinosaur show, if anyone remembers Walking with Dinosaurs.
Yeah,
amazing. Walking with Beasts, not quite so good. But
still good, though. Yeah. With Nigel Marvin, the legend. Yeah, that was just a complete change to the way we watched documentary shows.
Yeah.
Had new tech that we'd never seen before. Having them in there with the dinosaurs, with completely previously seen level of CG. Very
it
good.
It was awesome.
Yeah, and on a similar note, Avatar, obviously, that was raised the bar as well in terms of technology, especially with 3D.
Effects,
very
yeah.
seamless.
Yep.
In terms of
dull film.
Hmm?
Dull film.
It's good, I enjoyed it.
I would have preferred to have been watching Ferngully.
Yeah.
Story was a little bit woolly, I suppose, and it was followed quite sort of standard lines.
Yeah.
It's Ferngully.
What is Ferngully?
It's an old cartoon film about a section of rainforest in Australia called Ferngully. And an evil spirit called Hexus wants to destroy it, but it goes and cuts down a giant tree. And tries to kill all the fairies, which is essentially what the people are doing in Avatar. They are hexes coming, they destroy the big tree.
Yeah.
Try and kill off all the natives.
I immediately thought of Pocahontas, and I'm not sure why. I suppose it's the native.
Similar thing. Yeah.
Also, Pulp Fiction, I thought, changed the genre of film in terms of narrative structure, because having such a chopped narrative was quite a cult thing. What hadn't really hit the mainstream before, as I'm aware. So that was quite game changing as well.
Yeah.
And finally, Star Wars, obviously.
Yeah.
Need to be said, really.
I love the Star Wars.
Star Wars was amazing. What are we on to now? Question 11. Coming towards the end of the question run. Director Roland Emmerich is admitting to courting controversy over his new film, which questions the authorship of Shakespeare's plays. But who do you think is a fraudster of the arts? James.
I would say the majority of modern musicians, Justin Bieber, for example, is by no means a musician. He is a fraud. He is a gimpy little teenage idiot with stupid hair. So, yeah. Modern musicians. With all their auto-tuning, robo-voice stupidness. Quite equally lost points there, because I had to restrain myself from using foul language.
Yeah, don't want to do that.
Don't pull a Meyer.
Right. Joe, what have you got?
Well, I'm going to contest the previous point, because although they, I don't think those people have pretensions to art. I think they're filling a commercial gap in the market for what people want. There's the market for it, they provide it. So there's teenagers that want to listen to the same brand of music that's easy to listen to, is fits sort of preordained sonic expectations, and as well as lyrical structure. So yeah, I've got no, I'll happily coexist with it as much as I despise it. In terms of artists, modern art, I'm not particularly a big fan of, especially work of Damien Hirst.
Yeah, I can't stand the man.
Damien Hirst, oh. Yeah. With his,
Is it
half dead horse or something he did? Half a horse?
He had some sort of shark.
Shark in formaldehyde. That was it. Sheep in formaldehyde. They weren't even his ideas, he stole them.
Really?
Yeah, it was someone else's idea, he just used it and claimed it his own.
Got a patent piece of art, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
If I can elevate video game into art, which is dubious at best, I'll say Peter Molyneux. It's completely travesty. If anyone's heard of or played Fable games.
Oh god, yeah.
He has such pretensions to art, and it's not even close.
They hyped up Fable 1 as being the greatest RPG experience of your life, and it just wasn't.
No.
It was too linear, and it was just nowhere near as good as they said it was going to be. It was an alright game. They rather enjoyed the Fable series, but nowhere near as good as they say they're going
to
be.
Well, he seems to believe it's a sort of, he's, you know, the resurrected saviour or something, and he's creating these majestic works of art in his games, and it just isn't.
No, it's really
very
not.
Average.
Yeah.
Tell you what, you guys are going to be under pressure soon from Chris Stanley. On the subject of fraudsters, he's thrown in Rebecca Black.
Oh, good song. Friday.
Well, she's clearly included in my statement about Justin Bieber.
David Blaine. And all politicians.
Gotta love Rebecca Black's lyrical genius. You know, her choice of seat. Sitting in the front, chilling in the back. Which one will she pick? Who knows?
Her powers of sort of puzzle solving are just astounding.
Well, she tackles it through song, which is quite an ingenious way of dealing with the conundrum of what seat in a car she'll pick.
Should we have some points for Chris?
If you like.
So, I think we covered that. Fraudster of the Arts quite well. Question 12. I quite like this question.
I can't remember what it is.
The News of the World's owner has apologised to Sienna Miller over the phone hacking scandal. But whose phone calls would you like to intercept and why? Joe, would you like to kick us off on this?
Okay.
Would you tap Dom's phone?
no comment. but politicians indeed have to be up there, don't they? I mean, how good would it be to be able to listen into those conversations and learn the secrets of state? I'd be interested to know, is there a stipulation that you can't interact in the conversation? Are you just
listening in? Yeah.
Okay, well, in that case then, you know, I was going to say like phone jack or something to get involved in the pranks, but if I'm just listening in, then it has to be just heads of state and learn what's really going
key
on.
Key military personnel and...
Is there truth behind the moon landings?
That would be an interesting one to find out. James?
I'd probably say the same, because I can't think of anybody whose conversations I would particularly want to listen in on. Michael Bay, maybe, just to see what is actually going through his head. Because why he does some of the things he does for these films, I never know.
Interesting.
Maybe Garth Nix, actually, the author Garth Nix, so I can maybe find out just when the book he's been saying is going to be out soon will actually be out, because I've been waiting for it forever.
Yeah.
Just get some spoilers.
Yeah.
It'd be dangerous. He might leak some stuff to you while you're chatting away.
I wouldn't mind.
Interesting. Shall we have the scores before we go into the final round?
Go on.
Oh, hang on. Christopher Stanley's come in with a
banana phone.
Rupert Murdoch's phone must be tapped for the irony alone. Quite like that. And
tap the banana phone.
Tap the banana phone. I'll be honest.
Ring.
Where's the?
Unanophone.
Where is it? Here it is. Nope, that's not going to work. What should we have to do the scores?
Latin
vibe. Wasn't there a properly dramatic something somewhere? Like in one of the further pages? No, not that one.
Oh.
Further on. No, it's not that either. That wasn't that either. Keep going. Oh, Platoon. No, it was Platoon, wasn't it?
We clap it to this. On 9 points, it's Dominique. Very good performance on the interweb. It's Chris Stanley on 22.
Jolly good show.
Tied first at the minute, James and John, 33 points each.
Oof.
So it all comes down. It all comes down to the 20-second improvisation round. So,
I hate these things.
20 seconds. Get your suggestions in of things that these contestants have 20 seconds to defend. So, get on the Facebook page, 11 o'clock waffle with your put-ins. In the meantime, here's some songs. It's The Supreme Being teaches Spider-Man how to be in love. Very long title. Almost took up the entire page to write. By the Flaming Lips. Enjoy. That was Jimmy Gnocchi with Somebody to Die For. You enter the show at the end, half an hour early today, just because we were one man down. No Callum. Disappointed in him?
A little bit.
Immensely.
No Callum. But Chris Stanley and Dom have been playing on the interweb. Now we've been joined by a guest in the studio, have we? Is that not the one that works?
Should be.
Probably this one.
No? I don't know what's going on. Why is this not working? Let's try it now.
My name's Duke Nukem.
It's working. We got the buttons working again. So 20-second improvisation round. I've come up with them. Who wants to go first?
I'll let Joe.
Okay.
First time. You don't want to shout out, Dan? Okay, Joe. Duke Nukem Forever's out soon. Okay, and you have 20 seconds to say that Duke Nukem Forever is going to be terrible because Duke Nukem's body is based upon your own.
Well, Duke Nukem is a grotesque human being. And I'm not, so if it's based on me, you completely vexed me with this one, Mac, but I'm going to take the last 5 seconds to say I'm too grotty for video game form. I wouldn't translate across, it just couldn't work.
Hang on, I think this one.
Quit wasting my time. My name's Duke Nukem.
Oh, how do you feel, James?
Right.
It's an open goal.
Yeah.
Just gotta knock it in.
But knowing me, not being a football person, I will miss the open goal.
You'll miss it. You ready?
What am I doing? Perhaps if you tell me what I'm doing.
Quite right that Cheryl Cole was sacked for her Newcastle accent. I should know, I'm from Coventry and I'm stuffed every day.
But I don't have an accent.
Yeah, you do. You have a slight Coventry accent.
Which isn't exactly difficult to understand. The statement makes no sense.
It does.
It doesn't.
And my statement made sense.
I don't even remember what my statement was.
The defence that it's right that Cheryl Cole gets the sack over her accent because of your accent is just as bad.
Very well.
You ready?
Go. Cheryl Cole's accent is ridiculous, I should know, having a stupid Coventryan accent myself. Any accent where you can't understand words should not be allowed on television. People tell me all the time that I'm unintelligible and they just ignore most of the things that I say because of my accent. So if I can't get a job because of my accent, Cheryl Cole shouldn't have one because she's grossly overpaid, unintelligible fool.
Right.
That's all I have to say on the matter.
I see. Seeing what else we got from Duke Nukem. Hang on, you could always have.
Game over.
It certainly is.
Certainly is. I'm not sure. I'd say that's still a tie. We need people to come in with their suggestions. Should we have another song?
Yeah.
Okay.
Doing quite well to get a tie out of that one.
Okay, this is Lou Bega with Mambo Number 5. It's 12:40. That was Mambo Number 5 by Lou Bega. Super piece of music.
Indeed it is.
No doubt.
We are in a very tense playoff between James and Joe at the minute.
That we are. How will we ever solve this conundrum of a quandary?
I'm not sure. With another 20-second face-off, I guess.
It better be better than the last one.
I'm just trying to think. What could you possibly defend?
A hard-hitting political debate or something.
Okay.
Wouldn't be fair. I don't engage with the outside world.
I think it's quite easy. Do you want to go first or second again, James?
I'll go second again.
It's your time, I think, surely.
Okay, James can go first.
Fine, ask me and then don't listen to what I say.
Okay, 20 seconds. It's pointless having new people on the show. They don't know what they're discussing. Only the experienced professionals like myself, Carla and Lucy should be allowed on. Go.
Well, yeah, quite rightly, as you say, mate, new people on the show is just pointless because they've not been with the show as long as I have, or indeed any of the other long-running veterans. I mean, they have no sense of the structure of the show. The questions and music structure is too difficult for them to grasp in their feeble, feeble minds. And in fact, why you should ever want anybody other than me on your show is beyond me. I mean, who else do you need answering questions
Time.
Than me?
It's a strong defence. Think you can come back against that, Joe?
Got to compose myself after that
emotional beating I gave you.
Beat down. Quite brutal. Okay.
It was the crying that Dominique predicted at the start of the show.
I'm welling up right now. Okay, here we go.
Hey, I've not given you one yet.
Oh, do I not get to?
You get a different one.
Oh, can I?
You have to defend that only new people should be allowed on the show from now on because the old people are over the hill and don't know what they're talking about.
Okay, well, in the words of Barney from How I Met Your Mother, new is always better. And it's true that it'll grow stale if you have the same old people, you know, they'll have the same area of interest, same expertise. You need to introduce some new people also who come with new enthusiasm to do their homework, to research the topics that are given and, you know, prepare some interesting answers for the listeners. As much as we all love to hear James, you know, Carla, etc., on the show, and you know, staple fans will feel honoured to be in their presence. It's good to have new talent around and just have some extra insights.
It's tight. It's very tight.
Talent.
I think Duke's got something to say.
Ooh, that's gotta hurt. Game over.
That was Frank Sinatra with Come Fly With Me. As it stands at the minute, Joe is winning with one vote.
We've agreed between us to resolve this as a dignified tie, considering how the viewers are being remiss in their duty to send in
votes.
As
much as I appreciate my vote, I can't stand on such a mandate and will happily take do the noble thing. And
a noble act from a noble man.
A good contest, well enjoyed. While we're here, just put the word out for X-Men tonight, the cinema. Anyone's keen, get on it. It's a good film, so I've heard. Maya testifies to that.
Jimmy says it's good as well.
Certainly hope it's better than the last one.
Wolverine was actually quite good. Yeah. Enjoyable. Had portions of boring. Action scenes were brilliant.
I didn't like his constant CG claws.
Yeah, what was with that? In the first one, it was... But the original was he had proper stuff, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
And then in the other
CG
one,
for his... getting them out, but then and then on those attached to his hands.
Yeah, very weird. So there's another. Is this enough vote for Joe?
I'm like the tie. She's like the tie.
She's like the tie.
She's like the tie.
This is gonna be like the Carla incident again.
What was the Carla incident?
James, you Carla tied.
We did.
But James did win the defend the independence of the 22nd thing.
I did.
So it was a
Carla.
Close run competition. It's 12:49, the sun's gone behind the clouds again.
This bodes ill.
Ill? What are you up for the rest of the day?
Not a lot, really, I don't think.
Dave?
Seen the movie, as previously stated.
Yep.
come watch it. Aside from that, I'll probably go shopping, get some stuff, put some photos in for development. To be on Facebook. Seems to be on a Facebook near you.
Probably jolly good.
Catherine will shoot you some clips to entertain us.
Could we? Do we have to?
Do you not want them?
No.
How about another song?
This is... To close out the show.
Someone's expressing...
Oh, what's going on the Facebook?
Are you sure you're live?
Yes, yes, we're very much live.
Certainly hope I'm not dead.
Well, we can soon find out.
Another song.
No, we are live. Well, we're live-ish. There's a few seconds of delay. This is From Russia With Love by Matt Monro. Matt Monro with From Russia With Love. So this week's has been a tie.
We are jointly victorious.
Ceremonial handshake.
Not that you can hear that over the radio. Let's try and make it louder. We may have a chance of slightly hearing something then.
Okay. So we're going to leave you with the CD player running. It's been a good show, I feel.
Yeah. There may or may not be someone on after us.
We don't know yet.
Thanks for having me again, Mick.
It's no problem, Joe. We will be back next week, 11 to 1, for the penultimate show. Christopher Stanley will be on air. So we're just going to push whatever's in the CD player on and trot off. So we shall see you next week. Goodbye.
Bye, folks.
Bye.